Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could teach the gullible to never be so comfortable with lies they eat like comfort food? To disregard the bogus claims and pseudoscientific limbs. Can you imagine just how much indeed the world would change? No more political predators playing on the populace with ilkas and plots to shift and kill Metropolis. No more villains with the title in the Bible holding phony temper Bibles like the stuff they teach is vital. Imagine it was normal to have to prove a claim you made. And folks really feel ashamed expressing content that was fake. It's not to say we never make mistakes. It's just to say we go out of our way to show the evidence it takes.
Remain skeptical while you travel the world or even stay strapped. We're logic and fast, what it is, yo. Keep reality intact to help this truth grow. Question every claim, especially the ones you believe in. Remain skeptical while you travel the world or reason.
Hey everybody, I'm Rob Penzack.
And I'm Brendan McAuliffe.
Welcome to Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century. We're going to be joined in about 10 minutes here by David Niose, the author of the two books you see in front of you, Fighting Back the Right and Non-Believer Nation. Those are wonderful books that if you're interested in kind of getting some historical background with some political connection, understanding how things work, I can't recommend the content of these enough. So invite everybody to kind of check those out. We're going to run through some news stories first, and then we'll bring David on. So what do you got to start with?
Sounds good. Well, it's a rather bad story. It's in North Carolina, there's a congregation called Word of Faith, and it has just come out that there's been a slew of horrific abuses subjected to mainly the children within the church. They're on a 35-acre compound, basically, and they're up to about 750 members. It was founded by a woman named Jane Whaley, and her husband Sam. Her husband Sam was a used car salesman, and she used to be a math teacher. Now, there have been 43 separate individual interviews done by the Associated Press that have come to air, where these members have said that they've been subjected to several sexual abuses, physical abuses. They're shaking babies, slapping children. There was one instance where a man was a child at the time, was beaten so severely he thought he was going to die they were trying to beat the homosexual demons out of him. Mm-hmm. It was reported by congregation members when a baby was crying, it wasn't because it was hungry or it needed to be changed, but it was because it was possessed by Satan.
It's really scary that one of the problems with religion is if they weren't doing this trying to be abusive, but because they genuinely believe some of these things, like somebody is possessed, that drives potentially decent people to do horrific things like that. Shaking a baby isn't just shaking a baby. That can lead to permanent neurological damage or death and affect the rest of their lives or kill them. So that's really disheartening to hear.
Yeah, it's led by just this horrible woman, this Whaley, Miss Whaley. She reported that there was, when it came to light that there was a 13-year-old girl who was sexually molested by one of the parishioners, she said she decided to cover it up because it wasn't within, it wouldn't do well for the church. And she said to kind of hide it up, she said, well, the girl was 13, but she looked 20. Mm-hmm. So.
Right, that's another instance of these kind of misguided loyalties where they're trying to defend the church instead of trying to defend the human beings that are sitting there as the barbarism happens right in front of her.
Exactly. These stories are just absolutely terrible. One victim reported having being grabbed by the back of the head by his hair and having his head slammed into walls and on floors. It's just this horrific, horrific ordeal. They've also have 2,000 members between in Brazil and Ghana, and are affiliated with numerous churches like around the world. It's just this absolutely terrible, terrible situation. It was founded in 1979, and one member was sexually assaulted when he was 15. He was told he shouldn't come forward because he would be forced to relive the horrible abuses, and his name would be in the papers, and no one would leave him alone because of it. So he was forced into silence.
And you have the people telling him that are probably either his parents or his priests, his leaders, the people with moral authority that he's been taught to look up to, that he's been taught are maybe not infallible, but have this closer link to God and are giving the honest truth. and just the psychological damage in addition to the physical that this does to young people, teenagers trying to figure their way through life.
Yeah. So no, the worst part is there was little training sessions where parents and children would come and be told how to mislead investigators and how to respond to key certain questions, mm-hmm. like what to say when there's a black eye versus a broken bone versus a laceration like the head or something like that. It's just this confined, controlled, horrendous experiment, so to speak, on how not to treat children.
Yeah, and you think of when you hear about cults and stuff. So I'm not.
It is practically a cult. The children are raised and educated on this 35-acre compound. It's surrounded by a forest in North Carolina, and numerous complaints have been lodged against like the North Carolina Attorney General. But it was apparently very there's legal, quote-unquote, trickery going on, and where the church is trying to defend all five of the people being accused of various charges by the same firm, and they're running into trouble, and so this trial keeps getting delayed and delayed and delayed, and people are worried about people who are testifying not having the kind of the strength to keep having to drag themselves through it, because that's really the bad part about this.
Right, and I'd imagine in that setting, When you're in such a confined quarters, in a sense, that they will be gone from their community. Like they're making life-altering decisions, in a sense, and that they have to weigh out, and that the religion purposefully inflicts this on them, that they have to weigh out, do you want to be separated from this community that was the most dear thing in your life?
Yeah.
Or do you want to figure a way, and who knows what deals they're kind of offering in the background?
Yeah.
But you know, this should be a wake-up call to everybody that this is not strictly related to one little cult or one little religious group. Religion has done this. We've seen this historically. We've heard thousands upon thousands of rape cases and things being covered up, and even after it's exposed, wanting to handle it internally as opposed to actually get to the bottom of it. The last thing that religion seems to care about is the welfare of the religious individuals. It's much more concerned about the religious institutions.
Yeah, I mean, the worst part about the story is that it's not this surprising shock that some secluded Christian cult is beating children. It's, well, this particular secluded Christian cult is beating children.
Now we have political, you know, religious / political leaders that advocate the beating of children. They can find their biblical or, you know, whatever derivations they need to give them religious authority to do such things.
Yeah.
That's where is it in the process right now legally?
So what is happening is the charges have been brought up, but what the church seems to be doing is delaying by trying to coordinate their legal team, their defense, and it's apparently court dates and such have been pushed back days and days and days and months. And it just seems to be kind of this limbo section right now. But I think with this recent story that came out just February, late this February, I think it's going to come more into the public eye. So people might kind of push their politicians and their public servants to kind of take a stand and do something about this.
All right. Well, yeah, give us some follow-up on that.
Yeah.
Just to see. The other story we want to talk about today, this is actually an article by David Niose. Yes, it's time to politicize science. So as a lot of us are you know, painfully aware, we're now in this kind of post-truth state where it doesn't seem to matter what the facts are as long as you can get your media wing to say it long enough and loud enough. And since we're very insulated now, the right wing listens to their media, the left and you know, maybe intellectuals listen to theirs, and there's very little crossover. So right now, we're starting to see the importance of grassroots activism, and some people are really waking up to this. We had there's the Dakota Pipeline protests, there's the Women's March on D.C., and now we have a Science March on D.C. on Earth Day, April 22nd. A bunch of us are going to be at that. So you know, if anybody's interested in connecting with us, just send us something through our Facebook page. But you finally have scientists are realizing we can't stay isolated in kind of the ivory tower, in a sense. We need to be part of this.
Yeah.
And so one thing that David mentions is not all scientists are on board with this. Some of them think that this is going to, two things. One is it can increase polarization in our society, and the other is it can trivialize sort of the science that they're so concerned with, or that we're concerned with. So I would say that science is absolutely fascinating in and of itself, and I agree that it shouldn't all be about the technological advances we can extract from science. So that is fine to be enamored of science just for that whole learning process. In terms of polarization, David points out that's right. This should help polarize society in a sense that it should shame the people that are denying the science, leading to horrible governance, leading to ignoring climate change, leading to where we just ignore the facts that are plain in front of us so that we can pursue an ideological agenda instead.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm really thrilled to see that the scientists are going to be coming out. I think I heard that there might be a climate change one shortly thereafter. And, you know, how do you feel about scientists kind of coming out and entering the political
realm? I think it's really good because, I mean, like you mentioned at the beginning, the Dakota Access Pipeline was a successful protest. And it shows that we can actually change things. It's not just people waving signs saying, I feel this way. People are actually doing things and listening, and it can actually change public policy. The one thing I do think would be interesting is just to make sure it doesn't turn into a my science versus your science type of debate, which may happen, but hopefully it's not going to be the outcome of this
Yeah,
protest.
But so that's one of the things sort of built into science is it shouldn't be that, and the real scientists
exactly.
know that. And your real scientist says, here's what we think so far, here's what we know so far, here are the weaknesses in my own theory or in our group's theory, here are the tests that sort of speak against what we found so far, and here are the future tests we're doing.
Yeah.
The real versus fake is almost when you do put a Heritage Foundation-sponsored scientist to come out and say, well, climate change isn't actually real. That's why we actually need real science. We need media that's scientifically literate.
Yeah.
And we need to let the scientists speak about this. And if there's 99 climate scientists and one skeptic, show 99 to one, don't show one to one.
Exactly. Yeah, no, it's the idea that the media often portrays this as a one person here, and then they have the conservative on the left side and to the right of the host, and the Democrat to the right side of the host, and they just have apparently equal footing. But as we know, that's almost never the case.
Right, and science isn't, you know, as we're aware, it's not Democrat, Republican,
no.
It's just the science.
Yeah.
It's just that we're at this sad state where one of our parties, this is not historically the case, but now it has adopted this profoundly anti-scientific, anti-intellectual tact. And so it does often come down to Republican, Democrat, but that's not what it should be.
No.
It should be, here's what the science says. And if there are legitimate disagreements within the scientific community, that is wonderful to bring up. It would be great to let the American public see there's some nuance to this. We are discovering stuff on the cutting edge. You're always making mistakes and finding your way.
Yeah.
But that's not what the media focuses on right now.
No. I mean, science gives us the cell phone that allows everyone to look all their fun cat videos on YouTube, but it doesn't always mean people support it.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to wrap this up. We're going to have a couple minutes of public service announcements. We'll be right back with David Niose.
Disease because of my diabetes. When I was younger, I didn't want to admit I had a serious disease. Because of my diabetes, I lost the sight in my left eye. Misconceptions continue to surround this monster public health issue. But the simple truth is, diabetes can often be prevented and complications avoided. You're not alone. Understand the realities of diabetes and know that you can manage it and lead a full, active life.
There's an alarming trend in the world today. Everywhere you go, people are saying that cinema is dead. But cinema is not dead. My name is Count Simon Gauntley, and on my television program, Count Gauntley's Horrors from the Public Domain, I make it my mission to resurrect forgotten film classics. I promise to dredge the sewers and ford the stagnant streams of film history to ensure that no film is truly lost to the ages. Count Gauntley and FPA, keeping cinema alive! Alive! Alive!
Well, even though Joseph's been gone 18 months, we've made the decision to keep all his things as they were when he was here last. I finally just packed his toothbrush away like 6 months ago. It had been sitting on the counter in the bathroom. And I was cleaning the bathroom one day and I just thought, okay, it's time to put the toothbrush in the medicine cabinet.
So, I just moved in with his family, and it's embarrassing. The little one, he likes to go outside and crawl around in the giant litter box. I don't know what he's doing. I mean, I was born, and I knew how to use the litter box. Look at that! That's disgusting! Oh, poop already! You're making me nervous! Oh, okay, I can't look at this anymore. I really hope he grows out of this, for his sake.
This is Richard Dawkins. Doing commercials is unfamiliar territory for me, but I'm inviting you to watch Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century, on Fairfax Public Access every Sunday. Each week, the hosts tackle wishful thinking, religion, pseudoscience, and the harm they cause, with a combination of facts, humor, and community involvement. They challenge believers to defend their faith and give you, the skeptic, a voice. With live call-ins for viewers and streaming on the World Wide Web, there's never a dull moment. Don't wait. Look at them now on Facebook and YouTube, and remember to watch Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century, or there'll be hell to pay.
All right, welcome back to Road to Reason. So we're now joined by David Niose. David is an attorney, secular activist, the author of these two books right here, Nonbeliever Nation and Fighting Back the Right. He's also a former president of the American Humanist Association, another president of the Secular Coalition for America. He's currently legal director for the Appignani Humanist Legal Center. David's been on national TV and radio, numerous media, written media outlets. He blogs for Psychology Today. I've also been told that he is one of the most decent and kindest people in the secular movement. I cannot remember if that was Larry Decker or Roy Speckhart that said that. Either way, David, we're really thrilled to have you here. Thanks for sharing your afternoon with us.
Well, thanks for having me on. I'd like to know who said that myself.
I can probably track it back in my old emails, but I ran out of time. So can you start maybe just giving us a little personal background? You know, where did you start religiously? How did you come out of it if you did? And, you know, how did you decide to use sort of your journalistic background, your legal background? You know, what are you doing with that now?
Well, yeah, sure. I was raised Catholic. I'm Italian and Irish, so that's Catholic all the way as a youth anyway. But as an adult, I've been non-religious pretty much my entire adult life. I got involved in organized humanism after George W. Bush, entered the White House, because at that point I really became concerned about the religious right. Like many people, I have been concerned about the religious right for quite some time, you know, since the days of the Moral Majority and the Christian Coalition. But with the George W. Bush administration, it really hit me that the Christian right was not just a passing phase for this country, that it was becoming entrenched, and it now had one of its own in the Oval Office getting advice from fundamentalist pastors on public policy and that sort of thing. So I made a conscious decision, kind of looking at the landscape, how I might get involved in trying to change the culture, so to speak, that organized humanism would be a good vehicle for that. You know, I thought about other things, like maybe running for some local office or teaching classes, but it seems to me, and it seemed to me at that time and still today, that the emergence of the secular demographic as a more visible and powerful force demographically, politically in this country would really change things. It would be a great way to promote progressive public policy, human-centered public policy, and push back against the religious right. So that was about a dozen years ago or so. I joined the AHA board. I served a couple terms as president of the American Humanist Association. I've worked with the Secular Coalition for America as well. I served as president there. And now I'm running the legal center of the AHA, the Appignani Humanist Legal Center, fighting church-state battles all over the country.
So, yeah, are there anything going on right now, any cases that everybody should be aware of that the center is handling?
Well, we've got a lot of things going on. We have about a dozen cases pending around the country right now. We have a pledge boycott going on where we are encouraging students and really everyone around the country to boycott the Pledge of Allegiance to raise awareness of the under God language being added to the pledge back in the 1950s. You know, a lot of Americans don't even know that. They don't know that under God, his new wording added to the Pledge of Allegiance during the McCarthy era. So we've got this boycott going on, and we have students contacting us all the time, telling us that their teachers are berating them or even punishing them for exercising their constitutional right to sit out the pledge. We get involved in those battles quite frequently. We've got a couple cases at the appellate level in the circuit courts and the federal courts, one down in the Fifth Circuit in New Orleans, and another one in the Fourth Circuit, and another one in the Tenth Circuit. So we've got a lot going on there. And at the trial court level, we've got probably 8 or 10 cases, pending discovery. A lot of them are suing school districts for injecting religion into school, promoting prayer, promoting religious exercises. We've also got cases against municipal governments for promoting religion at the municipal level. So we're really all over the map, and we've got a lot of stuff going on for a small outfit.
Mm-hmm. Can you talk about, I think you mentioned in your book that your thinking has shifted a little bit about the importance of fighting things like, you know, God and the pledge, or, you know, God on the dollar bill. Where were you before, and what caused you to sort of take a new approach in terms of symbolic battles having a lot of importance?
Sure. Well, like a lot of people, I used to look at those issues as irritating, but not the battles that we should be fighting, because we should tolerate that religion in public life while we turn and focus on more immediate issues that affect people economically or socially, that sort of thing. But what I came to realize after being involved in the secular movement and really getting my hands dirty with a lot of these issues over time is that these symbolic issues are really more than symbolic. They affect the way that people see America and define patriotism. It's not just the words under God. What it is when kids go to school every day and say the Pledge of Allegiance, that the nation is under God, they learn to define patriotism in terms of believing in God. The nation isn't under God, after all, if no God exists. So kids are conditioned to see patriotism as something that's synonymous with God belief. And the logical conclusion from that is, if you don't believe in God, you must not be as patriotic as true believers. So it's the same thing with In God We Trust as the national motto, and other instances of religion very visible in public life. People tend to think, well, that's harmless. It doesn't really mean anything. Everyone knows that, we don't take that literally. But what I've learned from going around much of the country and engaging in discussions and debates all over the place is that those words do carry a lot of weight, and they do affect how people see the country and define the country. And they're probably a very big part of the reason why, even though non-religious Americans are about 25% of the population now, it's almost unheard of to see an elected open atheist in America. In public life, we have to see politics and government as something where religion belongs and non-believers don't belong. And that's not right. That shifts public policy and government in general away from reason. It really pushes atheists to the margins, and we don't belong there.
Yeah, I was watching a recent interview, well, not that recent interview, you did with the Friendly Atheist, and you talked about the way you went about the legal battles was you preferred not to use like an Establishment Clause defense, instead you preferred to use like a equal protection. Is that still your strategy, or because you're moving to the more symbolic issues, are you kind of starting to pull in the Establishment Clause a lot more?
No, what I was talking about there is a legal strategy that we were trying in one particular case. We certainly never abandoned the Establishment Clause as a tool legally. In fact, it's the main tool that we use when we fight these church-state battles. There's really no substitute for the Establishment Clause. But what we did do in this one particular case, and we tried it again in another case, challenging under God and the Pledge of Allegiance, is that in that one particular case, we asked the court to set aside the Establishment Clause and look at the under God issue from a standpoint of discrimination instead, because the Establishment Clause really isn't about discrimination. It's about government keeping religion and government separate. But even a Christian can bring an Establishment Clause case challenging a Christian cross on public property. There's no discrimination angle. What we're looking at is the actions of the government in violating the Establishment Clause requirement. In this under God case, what we wanted to do instead is say, well, let's set aside, for the sake of argument here, the Establishment Clause, and let's ask, does under God and the Pledge of Allegiance discriminate against atheist children and families by defining patriotism every single day in public schools under terms of God belief? And we thought it was a very powerful argument, it was certainly an innovative argument because it had never been tried anywhere before. And we tried it just in one state court, in Massachusetts. And the reason we did that is because Massachusetts is the one state that used the equal protection argument to legalize same-sex marriage for the very first time in this country back in 2003. So Massachusetts, under its state constitution, has very powerful equal protection protections. So we thought that that was the place to go to bring basically the same argument that same-sex couples use. You know, this is discrimination. It shouldn't be happening. But unfortunately, the Massachusetts court apparently has more sympathy for same-sex couples than it does for atheists, because they reviewed our argument. And they just said, well, you know, you don't have to say the pledge if you don't want to, so it's not discriminatory. Of course, the voluntariness of the pledge has nothing to do with whether it's discriminatory or not. The fact that children have the right to sit there and watch their class conduct an exercise that paints them as less patriotic doesn't make it non-discriminatory, but the Massachusetts court unfortunately didn't see it our way.
So what are your thoughts from your experience? That seems pretty self-evident, that if you have a classroom full of kids and one kid out of 30 is going to sit there and not do what all their peers are doing, that takes a lot of moral fortitude to actually do that. And we all know that a lot of people will be pressured into doing stuff, separate from the idea of just, you know, we're a social species, so they're going to tend to think this must be the right thing to do. You've got lots of psychological experiments that show you that. What are your thoughts about the courts actually deciding stuff because they look at this legally and try to figure out, yeah, that's the best legal solution, versus you have a court packed with ideologues and they know what they want to choose and then they figure out a legal way to frame that?
Well, the first thing I'd say to that is that, you know, I don't think the Massachusetts court is packed with ideologues, and that's significant. It's not just an off-the-cuff statement.
Because I'm thinking the Supreme Court and my limited stuff, but yes.
Sure, and we can go there in a moment. But what I would point out, though, is that the tendency to dismiss atheist complaints of discrimination, even though polls show that atheists consistently are among the least liked and least the most distrusted minorities, despite the polling that shows it, there's no argument. Courts, even liberal courts, have a very hard time accepting the idea that atheists deserve any kind of special protection, not even special protection, but just protection against discrimination in instances such as, you know, under God and God we trust, or with government consistently, just it's a never-ending tide of government rhetoric exalting religion and promoting God belief. There seems to be a disconnect even on the liberal side in the judiciary. An inability to see that this constant government barraging of religion and God belief pushes atheists to the side and is discriminatory towards them. And it just shows the tremendous hurdle we have to get over in order, you know, not just to win the fights in the judiciary, you know, against the conservative side, but we even have to convince more rational liberal judges that this is a problem. So as far as ideologues go, yeah, it's the way the courts are now, and with this new administration, they're likely to become more that way. There are a lot of religious activist members of the judiciary who really see America as a Christian nation that should favor Christianity in one way or another, and that is very much a problem. It's going to be an ongoing fight for the secular community for many years to come, I'm afraid.
Yeah, to kind of call back to the blog you did on Psychology Today, talking about the kind of the divisiveness of taking a stance on any kind of public policy, especially regarding science and education. Do you see it as do you see it rather difficult to kind of gain and gather like more atheists and humanists together because the idea of atheism is such a loose term and kind of defines people to a very small degree, or at least a lesser degree, as something like conservative or liberal or anything like that?
Yeah, I think if you look at the secular movement as, you know, one large entity, you have to realize that there are many sub-entities within it. And I guess that could be the case with any large movement. You know, even the civil rights movement, it had different pockets. You know, there are some segments that took one approach, or other segments that took a different approach. And I think we have to look at the secular movement the same way. Those who really want to emphasize humanism might be more likely to see the issue of God belief and atheist identity as less important than emphasizing humanist issues. Just, you know, name any progressive issue and it's a humanist issue, whether it's reproductive rights or economic justice. There are a lot of issues under the umbrella of humanism that don't have much to do with God belief or disbelief. Yet humanists tend to be atheist or agnostic or at least non-religious. And, you know, that's one arm of it. But there's also the atheist community that really wants to emphasize atheism and the existence and legitimacy of atheism as a worldview. And some people under that tent might not even agree with a lot of the progressive values of humanism. They might be more libertarian or conservative in their politics. But they're atheists, so they're over there. And I think we have to recognize that there are going to be these different tentacles, if you will, of the larger secular movement. And I don't think any one individual or entity is going to coordinate them all and get these cats herded, so to speak. But we do need to recognize that there should be some cooperation and some working together of these segments of the movement.
You mentioned in your book that free thinkers tend to be subversive in a sense that they don't just take something even from a friend as, you know, that's the correct view, we're all going to run with this. Everybody tries to think through things for themselves. Do you think that just that, you know, dimension of their personality or their approach to thinking everything through, does that lead to part of the problem of just not being quite as cohesive as we could be?
I think it's certainly an issue that's out there. You know, it's back to the herding cats metaphor that I just use. You know, free thinkers do tend to be pretty independent, not necessarily joiners, if you will. That, you know, they tend to be more independent and less likely to just go along with something because the group is going along with it. So I think it's one of the challenges that's out there, but I don't think it's a challenge that, you know, can't be overcome. I think we just have to be sensible in our organizing and in our activism and, you know, realize what we can get out of people and what people are willing to commit to.
Yeah, I know. You said that George Bush is what brought you into activism. That was the same thing with me, that I never realized that half of our country wasn't sort of critical thinking oriented to some degree, that people really took their faith that seriously that they would govern their lives by it and set social policy. Do you think that we've had the same thing happen with Trump now? Because you know, I've seen a few people in our community that have decided they're going to be activists. They can't believe they let this happen. They want to get involved. Is there some stimulus around that that will help us come together as a community to really try to affect change over the next, you know, 2 and 4 years?
I'd like to think so. You're absolutely right saying, you know, Trump has kind of motivated people. I saw an article recently with George W. Bush criticizing Trump and sounding almost like the voice of reason. And, you know, you have to chuckle when you realize that, you know, you're looking at George W. Bush as someone who seems sensible compared to, you know, who's in power now. We've certainly had a very big backslide. I think it's very complicated to try to analyze what happened, how it happened. All we can really do is hope that somehow this will be a catalyst to you know, get people involved and engaged to work for change. It's going to be very difficult, though, because it's just not that easy to get people on the same page about what needs to be done. And, you know, we have a Democratic Party that doesn't seem to really want to carry a progressive banner. You know, we saw what happened to Bernie Sanders in his run, and I don't know that the party establishment is going to open the doors to the kind of change that a lot of people in this country want, and the kind of candidates that could really take on a Trump and win.
As legal director, do you think there has to be kind of a change in direction instead of, like, with George W. Bush, it seemed to me more of that the Christian conservative was like a bottom-up movement where the people wanted these Christian values in place, where with this Trump presidency, it seems more people are put in place than make the rules that then govern the people. It's a top-down approach. Do you find that you're going to come across like a different legal angle that you have to take with these presumably new cases that are going to come forward?
Well, I don't really know what's going to happen in the judiciary under Trump, except that we're likely to see a lot more conservative judges filling seats, especially since, you know, we've got a Republican Senate right now. So, you know, the only obstacle to these appointments being made is a filibuster, and you can't filibuster every nomination. So it's inevitable that we're going to see a lot more conservative judges. It's already very tough out there, I'll tell you. Church-state fights are tough fights. There's a lot of obstacles that the defendant municipalities and governmental entities can throw up to make it hard for plaintiffs to win. We're going to see almost certainly a very conservative justice replace Scalia, but that won't really be a change on the high court, since Scalia was very conservative himself. But what happens, you know, who's going to be the next justice to leave the court? And will it be one of the so-called liberals? And if so, if Trump gets to appoint that replacement, we're going to see a sea change, I think. I think we're going to see church-state law as we understand it change radically, what that leads to, anyone knows. So it's going to be a very difficult few years, and how we come out of it in 4 years is anyone's guess. I mean, I can sit here and make my predictions, but I don't think anyone really knows. We can just hope for the best and fight for the best as well.
Yeah, I guess that last point you alluded to is what I was trying to get at before. I have a couple of sort of progressive attorney friends in Richmond. I think they do believe that to a large degree, this really, it's not just that we're a system of laws and you just need smart people interpreting the laws and you'll get roughly the same conclusions. That's sort of how science would tend to work. At the highest level, it really seems so partisan now that you just get, if you get another real conservative in there or two, we're going to see a sea change. even though all the laws on the books right now are still the same. So I'm not sure how the American public, if they apply any critical thinking, is going to keep buying into, yeah, we're a law country governed by laws.
Yeah, well, there's a lot on the agenda of the Christian right. A lot of it we haven't even really seen in the public eye because it just doesn't make it there on the nightly news or in the New York Times. But there's an entity in Congress called the Congressional Prayer Caucus. The head of it is actually a Virginia congressman, Congressman Forbes. It's been around for, I think, roughly 15 or 20 years now. But this caucus has about 100 members. And you keep in mind, you know, Congress only has 435 members. So, you know, almost a quarter of Congress belongs to this caucus. And it has an extremely dangerous agenda from the standpoint of church-state separation. It basically sees almost all church-state precedents since the early 1960s as erroneous, as something that needs to be overturned. They want to promote prayer in schools. They want to promote God belief everywhere. They want "In God We Trust" in every public building in a visible way. And they've proposed legislation such as legislation that would remove Establishment Clause jurisprudence from the federal courts. Now, what does that mean? That would mean that if you did want to challenge a governmental action on a church-state separation case, if you wanted to bring a church-state separation case, you would have to bring it in state court. Okay, and if you're familiar with the state courts around much of the country, especially in the Bible Belt, you have judges down there who truly believe we are a Christian nation. I mean, there's a lot of Roy Moores out there, if you're familiar with Roy Moore from Alabama. You leave Establishment Clause jurisprudence to state courts, and you're going to see many states that view themselves as Christian governments, at least in a loose way, if not a literal way. And this is where we could be headed. It's the direction we're going with this last election and with the GOP exerting so much muscle around much of the country, especially in Washington.
With the GOP able to just throw out the filibuster if they decide to go that way, is there any practical, tactics that can be employed to try to stop this? Or are we really sort of at the mercy, and if they go far enough, then maybe there's a backlash later? But is there anything that, I imagine you're going through all the strategies, is there anything hopeful or not?
Well, something like that would be a legislative action. So, and of course, it could be challenged in the courts also. But, depending on how it came about, just think of, look up activism in your encyclopedia or Wikipedia and look up every method and strategy underneath activism. And you'd want to utilize it if, activity like that started up in Washington. I would like to think that if something that radical were brought forward in Washington, that the Democrats would rally against it and filibuster it. I question whether that would really happen. I'm sure there would be a lot of very vehement opposition to it, but whether it would be considered important enough to many legislators to, play that filibuster Trump card when there are many other issues out there that are also seen as a threat to progressives. I question whether we would get the zealous opposition that we'd like to see to something that radical. Keep in mind, a lot of liberals really don't see church-state separation as one of the really important issues in this country. I mean, it's out there, they're on our side, but it's not a high priority as other issues are.
Yeah, are you worried because of that exactly, are you worried that people, rather us as secularists and atheists, are kind of gonna get left on the side of the freeway in terms of the importance of certain things to oppose and to filibuster and such?
I very much do worry about that, yeah, because like I said, I think, liberals, Democrats often kind of poo-poo secular issues. They're on our side, but oftentimes in a half-hearted way. They kind of hold their finger to the wind, and they want to know what their constituents really care about. And, you know, to many people in America, church-state separation is something they'd like, that they do believe that the Christian right is too powerful, but they, you know, that they are not in it the way that secular activists are in it. And they certainly don't worry about atheists being discriminated against very much. A lot of liberals really feel that if you're an atheist, you should probably just keep quiet about it, because issues like that are divisive in their eyes. And, you know, they want to keep progressives and liberals unified to fight the other fights. So this is one of the themes in Nonbeliever Nation, and actually Fighting Back the Right as well, is that it's so important for the secular demographic to emerge and to demand a place at the table, because, you know, until we are seen as something that shouldn't be hidden away in the closet, but instead, you know, we're 25% of the population, we're larger than almost any religious demographic, you know, we deserve that place at the table. And public policy, it's not like we should be defining public policy and shaping public policy according to our wishes alone, but we should have a significant say in terms of what public policy is and does. And part of that requires that all this governmental religiosity be pushed out of sight. It just doesn't belong in a pluralistic country where 25% of the nation isn't even religious at all. We are pandering to a religious demographic at the cost of a non-religious demographic and at the cost of rational public policy, because with non-religious people being in the closet and religiosity being played over the top throughout the political culture, that just leads to a more anti-intellectual culture, and especially a more anti-intellectual political culture.
So we have roughly 10, 11 minutes left. I feel like you have hours and hours of wisdom that you could share. I do want to get to one of your main themes in Fighting Back the Right. So if you could spend a few minutes, you know, kind of laying that out. You know, what are we now in terms of, do we have at all a human-centered policy? Are we completely focused on the corporations, the institutions? And why does that matter? Where is that leading us?
Well, what Fighting Back the Right does, I think, more than anything else, is that it tries to connect the dots. You know, I think many people in the secular community and even in the progressive community at large, people who are progressive, you know, perhaps followers of Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, or even to the left of them, they realize that there's that anti-intellectualism is a big part of why we're not getting human-centered public policy in this country. And Fighting Back the Right tries to connect the dots between the lack of reason in American culture and the poor quality of public policy that we end up with. And, excuse me, you know, you look at things that seem to obstruct rational public policy, you know, things like our over-the-top nationalism, our out-of-control militarism. You know, we outspend basically the rest of the world combined militarily. Yet, we don't. Most Americans don't even seem to realize that. You know, we now have a president who wants to increase the military budget by $56 billion, I think it was, and cut everything else, the EPA and every other department besides the military. You know, what kind of irrationality leads to this? And, you know, certainly our anti-intellectual culture is what is a big part of it. And, you know, our lack of truly valuing education. We give education lip service and even money in this country, but we don't truly value education, you know, as a core American value. In fact, you know, most of our culture kind of exalts anti-intellectualism, and kids are conditioned in this country to kind of see smart, educated kids as nerds. So, you know, we try to connect these dots and realize how we got to where we are today, where we're electing people like W and Trump and, you know, a GOP Congress where snowballs are brought into the Senate chamber as proof that climate change is a hoax. You know, how do we get there? Well, you know, I think that this anti-intellectualism is a big part of it. And what feeds the anti-intellectualism? Well, there's a lot of things, but the corporate culture is definitely a very big part of it. Corporations control this country, and they want to control it. That's their nature, to want to control government, because that's how it increases their bottom line. And we need to realize that the one reason we don't have human-centered public policy is because you know, ordinary citizens are not at the controls. Washington is owned and controlled by the corporate establishment, and we need to wrestle control away from that establishment if we ever want to see rational public policy and human-centered public policy.
Yeah, I
just have one quick question for you. You're talking about like human-centered policy as opposed to like corporatism. What exactly do you mean by like human-centered policy? Because it just seems like a very broad term, and I just would like to understand a little bit more, and so viewers.
Sure. I would define human-centered policy as more akin to social democracy, where we have, where of course we have universal health care and most likely single payer universal health care, because it's just sensible for a society as wealthy as ours and with the technological abilities that we have to deliver health care to everyone. It shouldn't be something that only the rich can afford, or it shouldn't be something where people get gouged by either health care providers or insurance companies just to acquire health care, which should be, you know, what could be more human-centered than ensuring that everyone has access to the to healthcare that is technologically feasible. It's just the only obstacle is cost. And instead, we have a government that funnels money to defense contractors, to that tailors healthcare to the benefit of pharmaceutical companies and insurance companies. You know, take a snapshot of Washington on any given day, and you'll see a city that's filled with lawyers and lobbyists. And you have to realize that 99% of those lawyers and lobbyists are working for corporate interests. They're not working for you. They're not working for me. They are working for the interests of corporate clients. And that's why American government caters to these corporate interests. And as long as we're catering to corporations, humans are second-class citizens. Corporations are people, and in this country, they are the first-class citizens. Humans are a second class. We get what's left over after corporations have soaked up everything to their best interests.
I did have a specific question, but before we get to that, since we just have a few minutes, is there anything that you want to highlight that you're working on with the American Humanist Association, or that they're working on, any projects you'd like us to know about?
Sure. Well, our legal center is very busy. We, like I said, we've got about a dozen cases cooking right now, and we have a lot of non-litigation activity as well, the pledge boycott being one of them. But we are sending out letters quite frequently, I'd say one or two a week anyway, to various school districts and municipalities that are violating the Establishment Clause. So I would invite people to go to the American Humanist website, AmericanHumanist.org, and go to our Facebook page. The AHA has about 600,000 followers on Facebook, and we always welcome more. Anyone who's a secular American, a humanist, should be connected to the AHA on Facebook, because that's where you get a regular stream of news that's relevant to us. So you can catch up on everything we're doing there, and I'd hope that people viewing will.
So what I want to say is that one thing that I really love about your book is it reaches, I think, very far out of just the normal stuff that I might read in an atheist-oriented book, and does connect those dots in a very important kind of like cultural, societal way. And then I forgot where I saw, I forgot if it was in the end of the book or somewhere I noticed that, it was on your wiki, that you've interviewed Howard Zinn, you've interviewed Noam Chomsky and Gore Vidal, and it just seemed like a lot of that stuff, I was wondering if you've read those guys, if that's part of what's kind of made you into the activist you are. So in the last couple minutes, can you talk about sort of how they've influenced you, if they have, and what you see as the importance of grassroots activism, maybe giving us some hope, despite all the top-down problems we have right now?
Oh, sure. Well, those three authors, among many others, I wouldn't put them in, they're certainly in an elite category as intellectuals and activists. But many other authors have influenced me as well. I have interviewed all three of them, and they're three fascinating people. We could spend quite a bit of time talking about some of the time that I spent with them. Gore Vidal was the American Humanist Association's honorary president when I was president. So I actually got out to his house a couple times and had an experience that's I'm going to write about it someday when I've got more time. But I think generally speaking, without being overly broad or too sweeping, these are three men who understood the whole concept of power and where it lies in America and why we don't get public policy that really reflects what people want. If you sat down people objectively and asked them what kind of government they want and what kind of society they want, they, generally speaking, they would talk about a society that conforms to the vision of those three progressives. And they understood why we don't. Chomsky's, essays on the responsibility of intellectuals and the concept of manufacturing consent and how society does that is a great starting point for people who are interested in reading a little bit about it. Or Zinn's People's History is a classic that a lot of people have already read, I'm sure, who are watching this. So, the only way to affect change, at least in a progressive way, is through grassroots activism. If you want human-centered public policy, nobody is going to deliver it except humans. You're not going to find institutions out there that really have great interest in promoting human-centered public policy, except perhaps nonprofits here and there. Okay. But, so humans will do it.
We are about to run out of time. If you're interested in creating change through humanism, we're supposed to have Roy Speckhardt on. It got snowed out that one day, so we're going to have him back on. David, where can people find out about you in just 5 seconds if they want more?
At the AHA, AmericanHumanist.org. Look me up.
Thank you so much for joining us.